Hey, what's up guys? Today I want to show you the solution for a problem I was coping with for weeks, maybe months even. And it all started with a new capture device, analog video, composite video and audio to HDMI. I had a very simple one in the past. I'm not even sure where I left it. But anyway, this is a new one, and this one is way better with the output quality. You can put it at 720p or 1080p, PAL NTSC, and you can choose inputs anyway. And the reason I removed the enclosure of this card plug here is because the DC input of this converter, which is usually in this box, obviously, is in a way of a normal SCART plug, which goes that way. And so I'm going to assemble this in a new enclosure, together with some other stuff, which I will show you in a minute. But I had quite a problem, and that is that every time that I connected the spectrum to this SCART2 HDMI converter, and then to a PC with a HDMI capture device, I had very strange issues on, for example, this plus 2, which I will show you. So let's connect it all up. So let's connect the video output of the spectrum plus 2 here to this input, and I have a small display here on the side so I can see directly if there's any video output. Then I have to connect the 5 volts to the box here. I'm assembling Pro One interfaces. They're doing this in between other jobs, but I wanted to show you this. All right, so I think everything is connected. You cannot see anything, but you can see something on the display here, but I've not yet connected it to the PC. So at this moment, let's press reset. When I go to the keyboard test, everything is just okay. So I can press keys and I see the keys show up here on the keyboard test program in the ZX Diecar. So that's okay. But when I connect one of these HDMI capture devices, so I've got three. These are the last ones I bought. These two. And this is an older one. And this one had terrible quality and didn't even have a proper sound output. So I think only one channel. So it didn't work. I removed the enclosure to see if I can find anything. So I bought some other ones. And then the problem occurred. So these ones are identical. I think they use the exact same chip. So it doesn't matter which of these I use. Let's take this one here. And so you connect the HDMI to this plug. And for example, use an extension cable like this to connect it to my PC. Let's see if it's actually activated. Yeah, it is activated now. So once I connected, I have to reset the input device and OBS. But you can see there's no signal because the ZX Spectrum is powered off. Now let's power it on and you will see a signal. So this is what we expect. Once I press the keyboard button, the keyboard test, this seems to work. But once I you can already see it. Once I touch the keyboard, keys are pressed without me pressing any key. This is what occurs when I connect it to the PC. And I learned that this occurs whenever I touch the ground of the USB connection here. So that means we have some kind of ground loop. It must have to do something with voltage level differences between the PC and the ZX Spectrum setup. So the ground is not the same, and once you connect them, you get some bias of voltages, etc., etc. I'm not an expert in that. But I wanted this to be solved, so hence I ordered several of these capture devices here. That didn't solve the problem, obviously, so I needed something else. I tried all kinds of things. I connected the ground of the ZX Spectrum power supply to the ground of the USB cable here. That didn't work, that didn't help. I thought I needed something like an isolator, so something in between the PC and the ZX Spectrum that disconnects the two physically, but still transfers the data of the capture device. And I found something like that. Let me get the first one here. It's in two parts at this moment. I think this was the first one. So this is a USB isolator, and it uses a, let me check, ADUM3160 chip from Analog Devices, which is a very common chip for this kind of purpose. This is a voltage isolator, so it inputs 5 volts and it outputs 5 volts by coils instead of a physical connection. And it kind of works. So it works, for example, with a USB stick, which is not too fast. But the capture devices like this one here, or the other one, they really need a higher bandwidth or higher transfer rate. And this device cannot deal with that, so the chip isn't fast enough. So I tried a couple of things, like this one. I just connected to the data lines to from the input to the output and just isolated the power, but that didn't work. So you really need this combination. So this doesn't work. I even tried it on something without the chip. So I connected this here on this very small. This was a power blocker, so I bought it for that. You can see I disconnected all the ground signals completely, but it didn't work. Bought another one. Maybe I thought the chip was bad. It's exactly the same chip on this one here. Didn't work as well. So I was puzzled. I was really stuck, I thought. Until I was Googling for one of those isolators that could deal with higher frequencies, because on the spec sheets, these ones only supported 12 megabits per second. So those weren't fast enough for HDMI capture devices like this, which output 1080p or something. So I needed a faster USB isolator for that. And I was afraid that I couldn't find one within a reasonable price, but I was looking on AliExpress and some other sites, and one of the products had a more advanced chip, I think the 3165 instead of the 3160, and that has become this one here. It says DC Tech, and I think this one was on Amazon for 40 euro, so not too expensive. It's like 35 pounds or so. It's still some money, of course, for something that just forwards the data, but without a physical connection. But let's see if this one works. So I'm going to disconnect the USB from the capture device and connect it to the output of this isolator here. And then I'm going to, you can see a small light in there. Then I'm going to connect the capture device to this isolator here. It's isolated when it comes to physical connection of data and power. So two things of it are separated. Let's see if this problem still occurs. So I'm going to test the same. So I'm going to press the K to get into the keyboard test. Let's see if when I lift it up, the same doesn't happen now. So this is good. This is what we expect. Nothing strange here. And when I press keys, we just see the keys that we are pressing, pressed the graphics here. So hence it says cap shift and 9. But this is what we need. This is the solution of our problem. So you can get rid of that nasty ground loop by buying a proper USB isolator that can handle the transfer rate of the device you're connecting it to. And this just works. So again, it's not cheap. So we have the analog to HDMI converter box. We have the video capture device and we have the USB isolator. So this is, I think, 25 euro, 30 euro. This is just 15 or 20 euro, and this is 40 euro. So in total, it's like 90 euro, something like that. I finally have a proper output from my ZX Spectrum to OBS. The audio is okay. I tested it already on these two inputs here, but I'm going to solder it all directly to this board on the bottom of it, because I'm going to build this all in this enclosure. A box I made for it, so it has USB inputs, 5-volt inputs for the box here, a 9-volt input for the ZX Spectrum, and a video output for the small display, which I'm going to replace by a bigger one. And then we have places for two voltage meters, so I can see directly if the 5-volt and the 9-volt inputs are okay. Then I have a switch for mono audio with the LED to indicate if it's enabled or not. I have a audio input, video input, audio stereo, and I have a 9-volt input, output to the ZX Spectrum. And I will I don't think you can see it, but it will go under the disk here, so I can reach it easily, and all the cables are within reach. So whenever I need to test something, ZX Spectrum or anything else, with analog video, I can connect it to this box. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm really happy this problem is solved now. Took a while, took some experimenting to find out what the culprit was and how to fix it. And I finally found the proper isolator here that works. So I'm very happy. Let's test it again. So I can lift it, nothing happens, no bad things. And let me just show you that the same happens again when I just connect it directly to the USB without the isolator. So you have proof of that. And you can have to reset it, of course. Let me do that. Right, so it's still where it was, but if I touch it now, all the things happen again. I think the keyboard acts like an antenna or something because of the strange issues that happened with the ground loop. That should be solved now with the isolator in between. I like that a lot. I made these holes, by the way, to get rid of the heat. Oh, that's really hot to the touch. That heatsink is very small, but it's hot. Anyway, enough of this. I'm going to continue working on these Pro 1s because I have so much work, so much orders. Can see all the crates. But okay, let's continue, and don't forget to like and subscribe, and I will see you in the next video. Bye!